Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidil Anbiya wal Mursaleen wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. من عمل صالحا من ذكر أو أنثى وهو مؤمن فلنحيينه حياة طيبة وقال عليه الصلاة والسلام الحج عرفة. Dear brothers and sisters, today is the 9th of Dhul Hijjah, and this is the day of Arafah, where people, all the people who are performing Hajj, they go to the Maidan of Arafah, they gather there and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, people who stay behind, they don't go to perform Hajj. They perform or observe fasting on the 9th of Dhul Hijjah, for which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned in a hadith that observing fast on the 9th of Dhul Hijjah is an expiation for 2 years, one past year and the other is the current year. Inshallah, tomorrow we'll be celebrating Eid al-Adha. We'll perform Salatul Eid, and immediately after that we will, you know, move towards the places wherever you are going to perform your Udhiyas, inshallah. Brothers and sisters, for today I have gathered a few information which you know, we must know. The first thing is that this is the day of Arafah, which is the 9th of Dhul Hijjah. And you know, whenever the month of Dhul Hijjah comes, it brings many things to us, memories, and a radiant chapter of Islam or history of Islam opens, you know, when the month of Dhul Hijjah comes. You know, people perform Hajj and they fulfill all the responsibilities which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has assigned them. But one of the most important thing which we learn in this month is the extremely significant principles and words that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam conveyed towards people in his Hajj, and it was 1 year before his death. When we talk about those principles, they are very important for all of us. They were very important at that time, because before the coming of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it was the time of Jahiliyyah, the time of ignorance. And we will talk very briefly about that. Islam came, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam conveyed Allah's message to them. And also, when we talk about the khutbah or the sermon that he gave in his Hajj, there are very important, you know, principles for all of us that we can establish, and we need them today and every day, and we will need them every single day of our life, my brothers and sisters. When we look around, you see whatever is happening all around the world, it is due to one important thing which we are missing, and that is sticking towards the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are very negligent towards what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded and towards what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has taught us. The day of Arafah, there's a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam where he has mentioned that إِذَا كَانَ يَوْمُ عَرَفَ يَنزِلُ اللَّهُ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ الدُّنْيَا يُبَاهِي بِهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ. When the day of Arafah happens, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends to the sama of the dunya, the lowest heaven. Yubahi bihimul malaika, and he feels proud of his slaves who are gathering there on the plain of Arafah, and he shows this pride to the angels, and he says to them, Fayaqul, unzuru ila ibadi, look at my slaves. Atawni shu'than ghubram min kulli fajjin amiq. They have come here, means on the day of Arafah when they gather there. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the angels that they have come here. How? Shu'than, ghubran, that their hair are disheveled, their faces are covered with dust, because they have come from far and near, from all corners of the world. And then he mentions, Ushhidukum anni qad ghafartu lahum. You be witness for this moment that I have forgiven them. Fataqulul malaika. The angels mention, Ya Rabbi fulanun wa fulanun huwa. Oh my Lord, there are some people, they are so and so, that they might not be good, they have committed so many sins, they have, you know, committed these, you know, sins and this and that. So the, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَدْ غَفَرْتُ لَهُمْ. I have forgiven them. It doesn't matter how much sins they have committed in this life, in their life. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, while talking about the significance of the day of Arafah, he mentioned, فَمَا يَوْمٌ أَكْثَرُ عَثِيقًا مِنَ النَّارِ يَوْمِ عَرَفَةٍ. That it is a day which has more people who are forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than forgiven in any other day of, you know, 12 months. So my brothers and sisters, we can imagine and we can understand the significance of this day when people gather there. Also, when we go and perform Hajj, there are several, you know, sermons that take place there, especially the Grand Mufti of the Haramain. He gives a big khutbah and big sermon, and also he talks about all those things. And importantly, the quote or the sermon of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he has mentioned those important principles which we need every day. We will go briefly, inshallah, my brothers and sisters, and then we will learn something, you know, for our daily life, and also we will try to implement them in our life. We will try to change our life. The first thing he mentioned, he talked about the sanctity of blood, sanctity of wealth, sanctity of honor. My brothers and sisters, he said, "Inna dima'akum wa amwalakum wa a'radakum," your blood, "wa amwalakum," your wealth, "wa a'radakum," and he said, your honor. He said, "Alaykum haramun ka hurmati yawmikum hadha fi baladikum hadha fi shahrikum hadha." It is honorable. It has respect. It is respectful in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you cannot violate the laws that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set for you in regard of your blood, your amwal, and your honor. And that is why when we open the glorious Quran, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about dima, shedding blood, he says, وَلَكُمْ فِي الْقِصَاصِ حَيَاتٌ, that there is for you a legal retribution when saving the life of any human being. When he talks about the amwal, or stealing, committing theft, or snatching people's property, he said, أَسَّارِقُ وَسَّارِقَةُ فَقْطَعُوا أَيْدِيَهُمَا, that for the thief, the male and female, amputate their hands, cut their hands. When talking about the honor of a human being, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about الزَّانِيَةُ وَالزَّانِي فَجْلِدُوا كُلَّ وَاحِدٍ مِّنْهُمَا مِئَةَ جَلْدًا. And this is to preserve the honor and dignity of a human being, that anybody who commits adultery, either it is male or female, and they are unmarried, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that if they are found guilty, then you should lash them 100 lashes. This is فَجْلِدُوا كُلَّ وَاحِدٍ مِّنْهُمَا مِئَةَ جَلْدًا. You can talk more. Open the verses of the glorious Quran. Open the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, my brothers and sisters. And we will find that where do we find ourselves when we connect ourselves towards the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Either it is about shedding blood, or it is, you know, snatching the property of other people, or we talk about harming other people and, you know, disrespecting them, or not honoring them. My brothers and sisters, Islam is such a religion that forbids all human beings to harm others. And not harming only Muslims. Harming Muslims, harming non-Muslims, believers, disbelievers, and all human beings in general. And not only human beings. Even Islam has forbidden that you cannot harm animals. Islam has forbidden that you cannot harm not only animals, any creature that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created on the surface of the earth. And that's why all these things teach us that Islam is a religion that gives us respect, that gives us honor, that gives us a right, that gives right to live peacefully and with tranquility, with harmony on the surface of the earth which has been created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Islam is a religion that builds brotherhood. Islam is a religion that puts mahabba and love and affection in the hearts of human beings. Islam is a religion that teaches to be dutiful towards Allah, the Creator. Islam is a religion that teaches all human beings to be dutiful towards their parents, to take care of themselves, their souls, and their properties, their neighbors, their relatives, and all human beings in general. My brothers and sisters, this is the teaching of Islam. Islam teaches us to be kind to ourselves, to all our neighbors, to Muslims, to non-Muslims, and to all human beings, and to all, you know, creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is something that gives us the honor, or we understand the rights of each other through the Quran and through the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Open the glorious Quran, you will find that how with a very detail Allah talks about the rights of husband and wife, that you know, their mutual rights, their married life, after married life, or you know, divorce cases, or you know, khula cases, all those things, my brothers and sisters. So we need to learn. Islam is a religion that teaches us to build relations with not only human beings, but with between communities, between nations, between countries. And the most important thing that it teaches, that there should be love and muhabba. All of us are the creature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't matter. You are a Muslim, you are a Christian, you are a Jew, you are a Hindu, you whatever religion you belong to, but you are the creature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said, "Kullukum li Adam, wa Adamu min turab, inna akramakum inda Allahi atqakum." He mentioned that all of you are for Adam. For Adam means you are the children of Adam. Adam alayhi salatu wa sallam was the first prophet. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent him, you know, from the Jannah, and his wife Hawa alayhi salatu wa sallam. And the day of Arafah, where people gather, the definition that ulama have mentioned, my brothers and sisters, that it is known as Arafah, or the plain of Arafah, because it is the place where both of them met with each other. You know, when they were expelled from the Jannah, Adam alayhi salatu wa salam and Hawa alayhi salatu wa salam, it was the place in the Maidan of Arafah where they came together and they met with each other and they recognized. And from there, the word comes, Arafah, ya'rifu, means to know, to learn, or to recognize each other. So, kullukum li Adam wa Adamu min turab. Inna akramakum inda Allahi atqakum. My brothers and sisters, these were also the words which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam talked about when he was giving his last sermon, you know, in his last Hajj, khutbatu hajjatil wada'. He said that all of you are the children of Adam, wa Adamu min turab, and you should understand your value, that Adam was created from clay, from dust. So we need to understand that we have been created from dust. And at the end of your life, what happens when you die? Where do you go? People bury you in the, you know, in the earth. So basically, my brothers and sisters, it is not your jism or your power or your wealth or your community or your nation or your country or your state where you belong to. It is the taqwa. It is the consciousness of your heart. It is the piousness. It is the piety that is in your heart, which is accepted in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why he mentioned very clearly, la fadla li arabiyyin ala ajami. Ajami means dumb, like he cannot speak anything. And Arab used to feel proud of themselves because they had the control of the language, of Arabic language. And they used to call other people as ajam, like they cannot speak, they are, you know, without their tongue or without a language. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned very clearly, la fadla li arabiyyin ala ajami. There is no superiority of an Arab over an ajam, and there is no superiority wala li ajamiyyin ala arabi, of an ajami over an arabi, wala li ahmar ala abyad, or of a red over a white, and wala abyad ala ahmar, or, you know, he continued and he said, illa bittaqwa, except with piety and piousness. My brothers and sisters, if you are wealthy, you think that I'm, you know, the boss, or I'm the leader. If you have power in your hands, you think that I'm the leader of the world. If you have the knowledge, you think I'm the most knowledgeable. If you have other talent, you think, you know, my brothers and sisters, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, through his sermon, you know what he is teaching us, that we need to be kind. We need to be very honorable towards, you know, ourselves and towards other people. My brothers and sisters, when we talk about the time of Jahiliyyah, what was happening? What were the disease that were widespread at that time? Shedding blood. It was easy and it was really widespread. They could shed, you know, anybody's blood without, you know, with a small causes. And it was felt as a proud, or, you know, as a pride for themselves. Killing was very simple. You don't have to do, just go and shoot anybody. And that is what is happening. You go anywhere in the world and you will find out that how many killings are happening every single day. Because we are negligent towards what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned, the glorious Quran. مَنْ قَتَلَ نَفْسًا بِغَيْرِ نَفْسٍ أَوْ فَسَادٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ فَكَأَنَّمَا قَتَلَ النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. Killing a human being, just one simple human being, is a crime, is so severe in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you have slain the whole ummah or the whole entire, you know, nation. My brothers and sisters, فَكَأَنَّمَا قَتَلَ النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا, that you have slain the mankind entirely. So we can understand the heinous crime of killing that is, you know, happening every single day. It's not just today, in the past, and you will see that it is increasing day by day. So there is no difference, my brothers and sisters, but there is one difference between that time and this time. At that time, they didn't have Quran. At that time, they didn't have the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. At that time, they didn't have the teachings or the wise teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But now, we have the Quran. We have the treasure of the hadith, the sayings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We know how to read the Quran. We understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us from the glorious Quran. But still, we are doing. And it's not only that a Muslim is killing a Muslim. Muslim is killing Muslim. Muslim is killing, you know, non-Muslim. A non-Muslim is killing a Muslim. A non-Muslim is killing a non-Muslim. So it's not just that, you know, one community is killing the other or one country is doing to other. It's not. It's just widespread, like it was widespread at the time of Jahiliyyah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of us, my brothers and sisters. So color and wealth and worldly positions and the lineage of, you know, that you feel proud of yourself because of all these things, they are not to be taken into consideration because of all these things or all these worldly possessions. Look at yourself. The color which you have, is it your property or it is the one that you build that color in yourself? It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that give it to you. Look at your wealth. You think that this is you who has gathered all of these wealth? No, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look your worldly positions. You think you have become a leader because, you know, you can be? No, it is because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your lineage, the family that you are born in, or the family status that you get it, it's not because of you. It is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has honored you. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and also in the glorious Quran, Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum, the most honorable in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah didn't say that if you have wealth, if you are white, or if you are black, or if you are reddish, or if you are this, or if you belong to Arab, or if you belong to, you know, India or Pakistan or Bangladesh or Saudi Arabia or Egypt or America or Africa. Allah says, Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum. If you have purity of your heart, if you are sincere in your heart, if you are sincere towards the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is the criterion, you know, to be accepted in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum. One important thing, my brothers and sisters, that's why we hate with each, you know, each other. There's enmity between our hearts. We don't like each other. That is riba, interest. And that is also one of the important points that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam emphasized when he was giving his last sermon, where he said that the first riba, interest-based transactions, I cancel, is that of the riba of Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib. I cancel it all. My brothers and sisters, when we look and go into the depth of this, you know, riba system, you will find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbid this riba or interest system because of its great harm and evil that it brings, you know, because of being involved in that. It ruins man's conscience and it corrupts societies. Because when you are involved in taking and giving interest in it, then you will not be giving loan, you know, like Qard Hasana, which Islam has encouraged, that you should help each other. And there's no sense of, you know, understanding each other, that you are a brother of community, you are a member of community, or, you know, we should help each other, there should be a cooperation, this and that, no, just simple, take this and give this. So my brothers and sisters, that's why Islam has forbidden riba. It is something, you know, that kills the sense of community spirit. That's why Islam is forbidding riba. It is something that, you know, creates or causes greed and selfishness among human beings. And it is something as a result that creates, you know, enmity and hatred between the hearts of people. That's why Islam, you know, has forbidden. Always we talk about the rights of human beings, and especially the rights of women. They look and imagine, you know, the time the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam became prophet, and he gave his, you know, last sermon where he said, "Fattaqu an-nisa, fattaqu Allah fi an-nisa." You fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about women. And he said, فَإِنَّكُمْ أَخَذْتُمُوهُنَّ بِأَمَانِ اللَّهِ, because they are entrusted with you. So they are entrusted with you. Now my brothers and sisters, this is an amana in your hands. Women or your wife is an amana. Woman, when we consider a woman as a mother, as a sister, as a wife, as a daughter, or any sister in the community. So they are the amana in your hands. That's what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, فَإِنَّكُمْ أَخَذْتُمُوهُنَّ بِأَمَانِ اللَّهِ. They are entrusted with you. So now it is our responsibility that how we understand our rights, how we understand the rights of our, you know, wives, how we understand the rights of our mothers, how we understand the rights of our sisters or our daughters, and in all, you know, the rights of all women in general, my brothers and sisters. That's why in the glorious Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very clear. من عمل صالحا من ذكر أو أنثى وهو مؤمن فلنحيينه حياة طيبة. Whoever does righteousness, whether male or female, and has faith, we will surely cause them to live a good life. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about ذكر أو أنثى, male and female. That means that it doesn't matter if you are a male and female. In the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in regard of getting rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, performing good deeds, or the number of rewards that you get for performing each deed, it is equal in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My brothers and sisters, he mentioned in his last sermon, and that is very important for all of us, وَقَدْ تَرَكْتُ فِيكُمْ مَا لَن تَضِلُّوا بَعْدَهُ إِنِ اعْتَصَمْتُمْ بِهِ. That is Kitabullah. He said that I have left one thing with you, and that is Kitabullah, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said that you will never be misguided if you stick towards the glorious Quran. And that is what we are facing today. How much time we give to the glorious Quran? When do we try to understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us, you know, from his commands, which he has revealed in the glorious Quran? How much knowledge of the glorious Quran we have? You will find hardly there are some huffaz. Then you will find barely there are some, you know, who, you know, have the knowledge of, you know, the meanings of the glorious Quran or the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why it is obligatory. You see this, the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, talabul ilmi faridatun ala kulli muslim. He mentioned that acquiring knowledge is an obligation upon every Muslim. And Imam Ghazali rahmatullahi alayhi has gone into the depth of the meaning of this hadith, and he has explained, you know, in several pages. He's mentioning that talabul ilmi faridatun ala kulli muslim, acquiring knowledge is obligatory upon Muslim. He mentioned that this is ilmul kitabi wa sunnah, that is the knowledge of the kitab and the sunnah. But we are the jahil. We are ignorant of the ilm, the knowledge of the book of Allah, and the knowledge of the sunnah, the sayings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Mentioned that ilm, acquiring the knowledge, is obligatory upon every Muslim. It means ilmul fiqh, because through ilmul fiqh, or the ilm, or the knowledge of jurisprudence, you learn what is haram, what is halal. How many of us know what is halal and what is haram? You know, there are a few things only, but there are many. Some say that this is ilmul ikhlas, And wa'afatun nufus, the disease that our souls have. So the knowledge of that is necessary upon every Muslim, because if you don't know the disease, then you don't know the treatment. If you know the disease, then you know the treatment that you can do it. So that's why they mention that ilmul ikhlas wa afatun nufus, this is obligatory upon everybody. Some of them have mentioned that ilmul falsafa, philosophy, there is an obligation upon every Muslim that they must learn. And some of them have mentioned that mu'amalatul abdi li rabbi, that how a human being behaves with his Lord, that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he needs the connection between, a slave and his aqa or his Lord, that is Allah. So it is necessary that every Muslim must have. Ulama have defined that this part of knowledge is obligatory and this is fardu ain. Everybody must learn it. For example, if you don't know what is haram and what is halal, if you are praying salah, so performing salah is an obligation upon every single individual Muslim. So if you are not performing, you will be sinful. So it means that it is obligatory for you to learn what is halal and what is haram about the salah, for example. What you can do, what you cannot do. If you don't do it, then you will be responsible for that. However, so this part of knowledge is obligatory and this is fardu ain. That is what ulama have defined, that every individual must do it. There is the other part of knowledge, which is, they call it fardu kifaya. Fardu kifaya means one person from the community, if he does it, then it will be sufficient from everybody. For example, ilm al-tib, the knowledge of medicine. If nobody knows, then the whole community will be sinful. So at least one person from the community has to, do it, because it's something, let's say somebody gets, falls sick. So who will treat? So there should be some people who must have the knowledge of, tib or the medicine. Like that, ilm al-hisab, for example, the mathematics. Or the other ulum, which you see that all our Islamic schools or their schools, they go through all the courses and they learn there. So my brothers and sisters, when we open the glorious Quran, you will find Allah talks about the Quran, Allah talks about the Sunnah, Allah talks about the fiqh, Allah talks about history, Allah talks about, geography, Allah talks about, those mathematics. Look at the rules of inheritance, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking very detailed. If you don't know the mathematics, you cannot solve the problems of those inheritance, problems. So my brothers and sisters, Quran is a treasure of knowledge. Quran is an ocean where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put those, or has hidden those pearls. And now it is our obligation that how we dive into that ocean and then we look for those, pearls. And, that is what is the Quran is. So my brothers and sisters, it doesn't matter what we are learning, just the ulum or the sciences which we are learning, they should be beneficial for us, for all of us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bless all those community, centers, the masajid, madaris, schools, Islamic schools, who are providing this education, because that is most important. In the glorious Quran, Allah says, قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Can those people who know and those who do not know be equal? They cannot be equal. So somebody who has the knowledge, it is like he's in the light. Somebody who doesn't have the knowledge, it is like he's in the darkness. If we have the knowledge, let's say of medicine, we are also acquired or required that we must know the knowledge of the Quran and Sunnah, which is obligatory for all of us, or at least that can help us to lead our life or to perform our ibadah. There is only one type of knowledge that ulama have mentioned that is we should avoid, and that is madhmum, that is like ilm al-sihr, for example, the magic. For example, if you are learning how to play magic on others, so that is haram. Like, tilsim or all other things where you learn how to harm, other people, so that is forbidden completely in Islam. So my brothers and sisters, the most important thing which I would like to say, if we stick towards the glorious Quran, towards what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned, and that is why he mentioned, in his last sermon where he said, قَدْ تَرَكْتُ فِيكُمْ مَا لَن تَضِلُّ بَعْدَهُ إِنِ اعْتَصَمْتُمْ بِهِ كِتَابُ اللَّهِ, that I'm leaving something with you, and that is Kitabullah, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you stick to the Quran, then you will never be misguided. And then at the end he said, أَلَا تَرْجِعُوا بَعْدِ كُفَّارًا يَضْرِبُ بَعْضُكُمْ رِقَابَ بَعْضٍ. He mentioned, and he's giving a warning that I have explained everything. Now you have Quran in your hand. You have the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in your hand. And also, I'm leaving. It was 1 year before his death. And he mentioned that, he gave the warning, أَلَا تَرْجِعُوا بَعْدِي كُفَّارًا, that after I leave, do not turn back like to be disbelievers. And that is what is happening, my brothers and sisters. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us strong Muslims. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our iman. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to protect ourselves, to protect our honor and the honors of other human beings. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to acquire the knowledge which is beneficial for all of us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us peace, tranquility, and harmony here as well as in the hereafter. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Jazakumullahu khair. Wassalamu alaikum.